at least in my understanding, not really about cinema, but in fact about time. Accounting for this, I want to confront Deleuze, considers himself also as a science fiction author, in the three phases of difference and repetition, with the classical theme of time travel. The special aim would be to explain a certain type of time image by the mechanics of time travel as depicted in one particular movie is Primer, directed by Shane Carruth from the year 2004. In his thinking about time, Deleuze is arguing against what I would call the succession model of time. This model suggests that one present event succeeds another present event. When the new present replaces the old, this old event is now the past, and so on. In his book about the Bergson, Deleuze asks the following questions. We are too accustomed to thinking in terms of the present. We believe that the present is only past when it is replaced by another present. Nevertheless, let us stop and reflect for a moment. How would the new present come about if the old present did not pass at the time it is present? How would any present whatsoever pass if it were not past at the same time as present? These doubts about the succession model and Deleuze's thoughts on cinema are in fact closely related. With regard to cinema, Deleuze is contesting a strong dogma of film theory which states that the cinematic image is always in the present. On the first sight, this seems very plausible. You could say that even if you try to show something in the past, you are depending on showing this past in the mode of the present. This is the basic dilemma of flashback scenes, of course. For Deleuze, thinking the cinematic image only in terms of the present misses the point. He conquests such simplistic models of time by inventing a beautiful concept, the virtual. In order for the present being able to pass, there has to be a virtual past, which exists already. So instead of the succession model, instead of the succession model where the past depends on the present event that it has been, we have a model where the past and the present paradoxically coexist at the same time. And therefore, of course, also terms like origin or beginning get a fundamental new meaning in this philosophy. We can say sentences like, at the beginning there was repetition and the origin is already different from itself. This paradoxical virtual sphere of the past is perfectly clear for Deleuze, although it has never been present. Departing from Bergson, who is the main source of inspiration here, this includes a whole theory of memory where you don't remember things as they were, and therefore actualize it in a present image, but where remembering becomes the creation of something new. Time is invention, or it is nothing at all, says Bergson in Creative Revolution. At this focus on invention and creativity, you can see why the arts, and especially cinema, are so important for Deleuze. In cinematic images, Deleuze sees the unique potential of making virtual dimensions of time perceivable. This is why Deleuze operates with two major concepts of cinema and not just one, the movement image and the time image. In the movement image, you are concentrating on what is happening right now, whereas in the time image, your attention is drawn to something not present in the current image, but nevertheless insisting it like a counting force. Besides Bergson, the other essential inspiration for the use regarding the philosophy of time is of course Immanuel Kant. To put it in very simple terms, we can say that Kant defines time as the form of interiority. So the form of time we are dealing with here is subjective, not an external objective succession, which the subject is able to express in a more or less adequate way. The only subjectivity is time itself, as we say that we are in time and not the other way around. What has all this to do with time travel? As you probably know, the paradoxes of time travel being a great deal in literature, logic, physics, and philosophy. Consider, for example, the grandfather paradox. If I go back in time and kill my grandfather, I'm never born, therefore not able to go back and kill him, etc. Nevertheless, I will have a special angle here. The question will be not under what conditions is time travel possible or impossible, but are these paradoxes, once we accept their impossibility, something that lies at the inner core of our subjectivity? something that's not working against how time usually is, but constitutes its innermost being, is time by nature a paradox? Maybe the time travel narrative offers new ways of fictionalizing and dramatizing the paradoxes Deleuze is talking about. Maybe this narrative is the perfect expression of what Deleuze means when he says that time has always put the notion of truth into crisis. If we look at the history of cinema and the various films concerning time travel, it seems like a dead end. Take films like Back to the Future or Terminator as examples, and we have a typical action hero, and the treatment of time tends more to a truthful narrative, to the actual and to the movement image. That does not mean that these are bad films, but just not suitable for the virtual dimensions of time that we see in that. So I'm going to take a look at what may be the only movie about time travel so far, the small budget film and science fiction film Primer, directed by Shane Drew. In the film, we follow the two main characters, Aaron and Abe, as they are working on a piece of hardware which can theoretically reduce the mass of an object by blocking information. At a certain point, they discover that they actually built a time machine. Two things are important here. First, they discover the accident, and second, it is clear from the beginning that they don't fully understand how it works, and of course, neither is the hero. This scenario, the engineers working secretly in the garage on the equipment, which is of course rather old because the film is from 2004, is maybe a great example of what Lewis was called a big large. So they don't really know what they are doing, but nevertheless they are inventing something, even though they might not be able to handle it. I show you now the scene where the two scientists are slowly realizing what they are about to discover. I want you to pay attention to the dialogue, especially, not so much what they say, because it's just really hard to understand, but how they say it. And it's unlike most movies about time travel, where they have, you know, one scientist-like character who explains to the main hero, and of course to the viewer how the time travel works, exactly. Instead, we have two scientists who are brilliant engineers, getting complicated things rather fast, and cutting each other's sentences. Therefore, the dialogue is very hard to follow, but it's not so important. So it's more important to see that it is depicted rather authentically. Also, because the director is an engineer too, by profession, so it's not a professional filmmaker, and this was his first movie. That's what you have to see.
Just one second. And all the five factors, once one variable, two time negative.
This is how time travel works in primer. For the general machine, instead of just blocking information, the box opens a channel in space-time. You put an object in it at 12 p.m. in the AM, and you take it out at 12:01 in the AM. But what they are discovering is that the object inside the box, the watch and so on, was passing a much longer time, moving back and forth between the AM and the PM very often. So about 700 times an even number. So if you enter at the VM and you are somehow able to interrupt this process from inside the box by forcing the object to exit at the end after an odd number of trips, you travel backwards in time. It is also mentioning Feynman diagrams. This is quite interesting because the director, Jane Carus, said in an interview that these diagrams, which like interactions of subatomic particles, inspired the principles of time travel as an explosion. Richard Feynman himself described the electron-positron annihilation process in the diagram as if it were an electron going backwards in time. Why am I telling you this? I'm suggesting here that these highly elaborated, inauthentic mechanics of time travel are in fact the place where the virtual is born. The very restricted circuit between the EN and the EN is exactly what the Lewis calls an image of two sides. So the image is divided, driven to a point of indiscernibility, where you cannot distinguish an actual image from its virtual double. Once the mechanics of time travel are explained in primer, the narration gets very confusing and unreliable, constantly oscillating between actual and virtual, present and past, true and false. There is no other movie where the time machine affects the whole structure distinctly. After the event of the time machine, Abe and Karen are building bigger coffin-like boxes for their own. They travel back in time to make money at the stock market. At first, they are very cautious because they don't know how the machine works exactly. Questions of determinism and freedom arise while Abe and Karen are trying not to interfere with the world during their trips. The problem is that they don't know which universe they live in, because roughly speaking, there are two different modes of time travel. Either you cannot change history, and even or precisely if you try, the results are already there and you need to fade. Or you can change the past and open up a new timeline, which is different from the first one. So these are the two modes. In primer, you can change the past, but where primer is extremely complex is that whenever you travel back in time and open up a new timeline, all this takes place in the same universe. It's not like Leibniz thought that you have many possible worlds existing separated from each other, because they are not together possible, or as Leibniz would say, incompossible, but they all take place in the same universe. So you also have many versions of yourself competing with each other. That's exactly what Deleuze means when he said that time is the notion of two different crises. Therefore, he claims the powers of the force. It is the power of the force which replaces and supersedes the form of the true, because it poses the simultaneity of incompossible presence or the coexistence of not necessarily true past. So this power of the force is obviously at work in primer. Not only does primer bring the notion of the virtual to some extent, but, and this is my major point here, also helps understanding one special type of time image, which could be called mysterious in the sense that Deleuze writes only very few lines about it. He says, the third time image concerns the series of time, which brings together the before, the after, and the becoming, instead of separating them. Its paradox is to introduce an enduring interval in the moment itself. The fact that Deleuze speaks of series leads across back to his early thoughts on structuralism. In his essay, How Do We Recognize Structuralism, we find already emphasis on the virtual and critique of the succession model. It seems like his concepts of structure and time are closely related. So what does the series of time mean? It means that, against the succession model, the present always splits up. It consists at least of two coexisting series brought together and become. A structure for Deleuze is a plurality of different series related to each other through a paradoxical element circulating between them. As he says, the two series of the structure are always divergent, a version of the laws of differentiation, but this singular object is the convergence point of the divergent series as such. isn't this paradoxical element which marks the convergence point of the divergent series, isn't this nothing other than the time machine itself? Isn't it exactly this object which is always displaced in relation to itself but always missing from its place? So isn't this the time machine? To give you an idea how elaborate and complex the structure of time is, here you have a diagram I found mapping 9 different series. As you can imagine, there is many views of Spinoza's time as an intellectually very challenging field. My point is not so much that, you know, if you think hard enough, you can put the events in a coherent order, but that at a certain point, you can't distinguish anymore between true or false, actual or virtual. And this is, of course, also where this maps, where this map reaches its limits. And as far as I know, there still exists not one fully coherent interpretation of the movie, the no answer of questions. Now I want to show you two versions of the same scene located around here, which kind of sums up the uncertain images of the driver.
There it is. It's been calling all morning. Where'd you go? To work or sell? Out there. Really? Watch that. That's Caroline's mission. Who's up? I don't even know what. Do you have anything important to tell me? I'll bring out a pilot in any day with an important cortex semi. Just, I was going to give you this big speech about how we've been friends for a long time, built up trust, and I believe in you. But how about this instead? If you can work this out, promise to do the few small things I ask you, I will in return show you the most important thing that any living organism has ever witnessed.
Example, Lorenz's time travel film, Jim Henson, Deleuze brings as an example for the second type in Italian English. My idea is that we can clearly distinguish these two types by explaining how the time machine works within the film. In Chitensi 10, the hero is accidentally jumping from one layer of the past to the next. But I would say that time is in fact doing a lot more than that. Instead of just experiencing the past, it really brings together a divergent series of time in form of becoming. But the second type is oriented towards the past, maybe with the third type that is trying to think of the future. And what other ways are there to think the future than in forms of science fiction? To confront the Deleuze with the uncertain virtual and paradoxical images of Primer may reveal something about Deleuze's own futuristic narration, oscillating between stringently arguing science and potentially misleading fiction. Therefore, the limits of philosophy, science, and art of learning, and new philosophical practices of writing and arguing seem to emerge. It's all a question of time and of what philosophy will be in the future. Time is invention or is nothing at all.
Thanks very much. I think we have time for at least one question. Any questions? Maybe I'll start up with one. When we think about time travel, what we often think about is memory, and that's what kind of breaks causes the person to break down, and kind of breaks the machine in a sense, is the fact that there's already memory. And I was wondering if you wanted to speak to that notion in terms of your relationship with this using this as an example, actual time travel, in terms of, for instance, Bergsonism and the construction of the past and so on.
Yeah, I would say I took Bergsonism as a starting point for explaining the virtue and so on. But of course, this is why I brought the two examples. The second, when they're dealing with memory and the past, it's more. And here comes across first to mind, which is written by Bernard. Yeah, and he treats the time travel narrative exactly in the way of memory. So you jump to different layers of the past. Yeah, living your past and on. But this is not the case in Primer. In Primer, you have really. This past is absolutely not something you can predict, but it's not necessarily true. You can always go back, and therefore also the it's like an artificial construction. Everything, yeah. It's more, and this is also because. Talked of two different versions of time travel narrative. Yeah? In the first one, you cannot change the past in a way, and in the second one, you can change the past. And I would say that that René's feeling is exactly dealing with a model where the past is not really changing. Yeah? But in the second version of how time travel works, as in Primer, the past is a much more unstable thing.
Do you want to follow up
there? Is it really that you change the past in your examples, because in Bergsonic it's much more about the coexistence of the past, as you said. So would it not be that you add in the diverse examples and the und, what you said, that you simply add a new timeline, as you said. So you are not really changing the other timeline, but you produce a new and often a new timeline, for which would not so much be of changing the other timeline, but adding a new timeline to the already existing.
Yeah. Of course, this is not the possible that was very simplistic question, because René's feeling is also very different from Venus, where you little past such a formative a flashback scene. Yeah? So he is, of course, he deals with these virtual spheres, the virtual sphere of time. And of course, this point of indestructibility I talked about, yeah, is very important. So that you don't, the very confusing field about, confusing fact about time is that where you have this, all these different timelines, yeah, that you don't know on which timeline you're on right now. Yeah? So you don't know if this is, and therefore also past and present, it gets a fundamental meaning. Don't know if this is